Now we can describe a distinction between different kinds of arguments. And it's going to largely rely on this distinction of support. And so we're going to talk about deduction and induction, deductive arguments and inductive arguments. And Poynman gives some explanation for this. I want to go a little bit deeper. So this is largely a distinction between whether the premises give the conclusion with necessity or if the premises give the conclusion with probability. Does it make the conclusion certain or does it make it likely? So it's a degree of support. One fully supports, the other one partially supports or mostly supports. So a deductive argument incorporates the claim that it's impossible for the conclusion to be false if the premises are true. So deductive arguments, their goal is to say the premises give you the conclusion with certainty. There's no way that conclusion can be false if, this is critical, if the premises are true. It doesn't say that the premises are true, it just means that the premises give you the conclusion if they're true. On the other hand, inductive arguments don't make that strong of a claim. They're merely shooting for making the conclusion likely. It's improbable that the conclusion's false when the premises are true. So even if the premises are true, it doesn't guarantee the conclusion, it just makes it likely. Plausible, more likely than not, something like that. So inductive arguments are not trying to be as strong. They're just aiming for getting the conclusion unlikely to be false. So some examples of deductive arguments. All chickens are barely smarter than a rock. This animal is a chicken. So conclusion, this animal is barely smarter than a rock. If you accept the premises, you have to accept the conclusion. Now, you could say that premise one is false, and that might be a reason why you might reject the conclusion. But if premise one and two are true, there's no way the conclusion can be false. It's a deductive argument. It's going for a guarantee, and it's succeeding if the premises are true. Now, suppose we said the conclusions are false, then we've got to do something to the argument. We've got to shift it in a big way. If the conclusion's false, there's no way that that squares with what is already accepted in premise one and premise two. If I accept that all chickens are barely smarter than a rock and this animal is a chicken, it would be weird if I accepted the fact that this animal is not barely smarter than a rock, if I allowed this some exception like this. I should instead, if I'm going to accept that conclusion, I should make the premise something like, not all, but instead most. So basically, the conclusion couldn't be different unless it really messes up the argument. It's inconsistent is another way of saying it. Now consider this other argument. Most Princeton students are from the state of New Jersey. This person is a Princeton student. I'll call her Ashley. This person is a Princeton student. So, conclusion, this person is from the state of New Jersey. Sounds pretty reasonable, but you're only given it with probability. It doesn't guarantee that conclusion's true. So it's going to be inductive. There's a little bit of wiggle room. You could find a student who's not from the state of New Jersey, and it doesn't mean the argument doesn't like that the premises are bad. No, your support's great. It just turned out that you found that weird one case that are outside of most Princeton students, the few students that just aren't. So even if you accept the premises, could you conclude maybe something that's the opposite? Sure. My friend Ashley, she's from Canada. She's not from New Jersey. So even though premise one is true and premise two is true and it makes the conclusion likely, my friend Ashley is actually contrary to the norm. She's one of those few that's from Canada, not New Jersey. So it's not inconsistent. The argument does not have that strong of a claim. There's wiggle room. It allows that a few students aren't from New Jersey. So inductive arguments are not going for being airtight. They're going for probable. Other types of deductive arguments include arguments from math or from definition. So Liam is a bachelor. Therefore, Liam is unmarried. Why? Because I already know from the definition of bachelor that it's like something like an unmarried male. So knowing the definition of bachelor gives me the conclusion. There are plenty of other types of arguments where you've got like two premises and a conclusion, categorical syllogisms, like meerkats are members of the mongoose family. All members of the mongoose family are carnivores. Therefore, the meerkat is a carnivore. We're talking about groups of things or categories, and we're relating these categories to each other. All A's are B's. All B's are C's. Therefore, all A's are C's. I'm talking very abstractly, but it's basically the way this argument is set up. Meerkats are carnivores. And notice that the three dots right there labeling the conclusion, that could be put there instead of a C, because that's just a therefore symbol. There are plenty of other kinds of syllogisms, arguments that have two premises and one conclusion, like a hypothetical syllogism. If I'm a dog, then I have four legs. If I have four legs, then I have four paws. Therefore, if I'm a dog, then I have four paws. Now, I'm not actually a dog, so this argument doesn't really apply to me at the outset, but if I were a dog, I would have four legs. And if I had four legs, then I would have four paws. And so if you think abstractly, it's if A, then B, if B, then C. Therefore, if A, then C. You can like skip B, go straight from A to C. Again, this is thinking a little bit abstractly, but the idea here is we've got just an argument with two premises, and it gives us the conclusion. And it's obvious that the conclusion follows if the premises are true. So it's a deductive argument. There are other arguments, disjunctive syllogism. So the syllogism is going to be a two-premise argument with a conclusion, and a disjunction is going to be one that has to do with either or. So either choose Charmander or Bulbasaur. Either choose Charmander or Bulbasaur. Bulbasaur? Seriously? No, not Bulbasaur, so I'm not choosing Bulbasaur. So I choose Charmander. Char. So you've got two options, A or B. Well, I'm not choosing this one, so I gotta choose that one. So I'm not having B, so then I have to have A. Very straightforward argument. There are also different kinds of inductive arguments. These are all going to be arguments that are just showing that something's probable or likely, but they're not trying to go for airtight. They're just saying, given the evidence, you should be accepting the conclusion. But if it turns out that the conclusion is false, well, oops, like we weren't trying to be like 100% airtight. So predictions. If you talk about the future, probable futures, this is always going to be something that you're only likely to be right. You can't know the future with certainty. So if I've gone to a certain vending machine in one of the academic buildings and I buy a Reese's, I notice that whenever I put money in, it gives correct change in return. But I could be wrong about it sometimes giving me correct change in return next time. Sure, it's likely to give me the correct change, but there's no guarantee. It's a prediction, and it's fallible. It could be false. Or more controversial, the sun has come up every day, every 24 hours thus far, at least in my case, over 12,000 times. Tomorrow will be like the past in this respect, so the conclusion, the sun will rise tomorrow. It's possible that the sun won't rise tomorrow, but it's probable given what we've experienced already, right? Other types of arguments that are inductive, that are not airtight, but just trying to get you likelihood. The meerkat is closely related to the suricat. Suricat thrives on beetle larvae. Well, what would you likely think is true? Well, they've got all these different things in common. Probably the meerkat thrives on beetle larvae. Or generalization. Every apple I put in the water has floated. Therefore, all apples float in water. Maybe it's a prediction. You could construe it like the next one I put in. But if you just think in general, apples float in water, that's not a prediction. It's just saying something true about all apples and how they relate to water. Why? Because everything you've looked at before where apples float in water seem like it's a good enough reason to think it's just true about all apples. You could have arguments from authority. My roommate keeps track of the stats of every buffalo game, and he says the Buffalo Bulls crushed a certain team last week. So the Buffalo Bulls crushed Robert Morris that week. Now, it could be that my roommate's wrong about this, but probably I can trust him. Why? Because he's the kind of authority that would know about this type of thing. And it's unlikely that he would lie about it either.